I'm glad to see everybody here. Welcome. And let's worship together. It's good to see some of you we haven't seen in a while. It's good to see each and every one of your faces. So let's open our hearts and minds and worship. Join me in the call to worship, if you will, please. Why is this night different from all other nights? And yet we gather here tonight as new covenant people. The Passover meal becomes the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. Which is the other meaning of tonight.
Our prayer, the rest,
the sham of the trial and an execution. We gather to remember that Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Lord, accept our worship and hear our prayers. Amen. Let's stand and sing. Please be seated. And join me, if you will, in our prayer for mercy. Let's lift our voices up, each of us individually, mingling our voices with others so that the one voice of our body rises up to God's throne. Let's pray these words together, saying, Merciful Savior, out of your love you laid down your life for us. We are awestruck by the extravagance of your sacrifice. We also confess that we have failed to go and do likewise. We have failed to be salt and light. We have not trusted you or followed your sacrifice with our own. Forgive us, Lord. Forgive our casual attitude toward the cross and our forgetfulness of what our sin cost you. Amen. Join us. About to act out together is recorded here in Luke chapter 22. When the hour came, he took his place at the table and the apostles with him. He said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. Then he took a cup. And after giving thanks, he said, Take this and divide it amongst yourselves. For I tell you that from now on I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. Then he took a loaf of bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And he did the same with the cup after supper, saying, This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. But see, the one who betrays me is with me, and his hand is on the table. For the Son of Man is going as it has been determined, but woe to that one by whom he is betrayed. Then they began to ask one another which one of them it could be who would do this. And this, dear friends, is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's prepare to come to the Lord's table. Let's sing together.
Thank you.
Join me, if you will, in the great Thanksgiving. Jesus tells us, "Come to me, all you that are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." For I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls.
Jesus is the bread of life.
When we come to him, we will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never thirst. Blessed are we if we hunger and thirst for righteousness, and we will be filled. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. It is right to give our thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. Therefore, we praise you, O God. Indeed, remembering this night and all that it proclaims to us and all that we celebrate and commemorate, we join now our voices with all the faithful of every time and place who forever sing to the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who come in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Tonight's the night. Every first Sunday when we gather, whether it's at 9:30, 3 miles from here, or just inside this building, we hear the words proclaimed that happened on this night. When the 1,000-year tradition of the Passover celebration was changed forever into this sacrament. On that night when Jesus gathered, knowing this was the last night of his life here on earth amongst us, he took bread, and when he had blessed it, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is not the Paschal Passover any longer. It's my body, and it's broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, my dear friends, he took the cup after supper, the cup of the new covenant sealed in his blood, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This indeed is my blood, which is shed for you for the remission of your sins. Drink ye all of it." For as long as we eat this bread and drink this cup, as long as we gather and remember this night and what begins now and runs through Sunday, we proclaim our Lord's death until he returns. These are God's gifts for God's people. This is the Lord's table. So he invites us to come and eat. Take your time. We are not in a hurry. Prepare your soul. Pray if need be. And if you would like to bring an offering as you come forth, please do. The baskets will be fine. And we can save that to share with our neighbors. But as you come, come fully aware of what we are doing and what it is we celebrate and remember. This is the Lord's table. So come and eat. Everything, and I literally mean everything, is ready. Amen. Jesus reminds us, I'm the bread of life. Apart from me, you can do nothing. With me and through me, you can do all things. Body of our Lord Jesus Christ, shed for us and broken for us. The blood of the new covenant, shed for us. Amen. Let's pray again. O God of all grace, your Son Jesus changed the Passover celebration forever so that as we gather and remember his last night on earth, we can remember and celebrate this sign of his great love for us. May that love shown in his body and blood be visible in our lives as fruits of his redemption. We ask in the name of the Lamb, Jesus, our Messiah, who reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Hear us as we pray the words that Jesus has given us as we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's sing again. Stay seated.
Thank you.
camp came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he reached the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not come into the time of trial." Then he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, knelt down and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." Then an angel from heaven appeared to him and gave him strength. In his anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. When he got up from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping because of grief. And he said to them, "Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not come into the time of trial." This too is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. He seized him and led him away, bringing him into the high priest's house. But Peter was following at a distance. When they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat among them. Then a servant girl, seeing him in the firelight, stared at him and said, "This man also was with him." But he denied it, saying, "Woman, I do not know him." A little later, someone else, on seeing him, said, "You are also one of them." But Peter said, "Man, I am not." About an hour later, still another kept insisting, "Surely this man also was with him, for he is a Galilean." But Peter said, "Man, I do not know what you are talking about." At that moment, while he was still speaking, the cock crowed. The Lord turned and looked at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, "Before the cock crows today, you will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly. And this too is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Peter's the one that we have to love a little bit. At the same time, we recognize in him what a template for what not to be. He's both. And I think tonight we can perhaps identify a little with him. Peter, give him credit. The disciples have fled. They've run. John ran naked because someone had a hold of his cloak. They've already gone. They've scattered like cockroaches while the light comes on. But Peter, God love him. He's followed, even if it was at a distance. He followed as they led Jesus to the high priest's house. And it might sound strange to us that they kindle a fire in the courtyard, but That's the way things happened then. The priests, the Sanhedrins, the scribes indoors, they don't care what the common people are doing outside because they've got their sham of a trial. They're finally getting their wish. Finally, he has stepped into their trap and they've got him. They can crush him. But Peter, alone of all the disciples, has followed. He's a little like Icarus, if you remember the legend. Icarus, the one who flew and was amazed. He and his father Daedalus had been given the gift of flight that no one else had ever had, but Icarus flew too high. He did better, higher than anyone else, and then the wax melted his wings and he fell farther to his death. Peter is like that. He follows Jesus. He shows us courage that no other disciple has. And then right at the moment when he has the testimony and witness to go down through all the ages, what does he do but blow? The servant girl looks at him and says, "You're one of them." "No, I'm not." Later on, someone else says that. Did you notice it said later on, by the way, or about an hour after one of them? This is going on all night long. Peter's sitting by the fire and he's denying Jesus, not thinking about it. He slunk away and followed in the distance. But when push came to shove, "I don't know him. What are you talking about?" Luke is kinder to Peter than is Matthew. Matthew is the one who records he claimed not to know Jesus and betrayed him by cursing. Well, that's not just cursing like we would think of it. The Greek word used right there is the same root that we get the word anathema from. If something is declared anathema, it's gone. It doesn't exist. We have no use for it. When the Amish shun someone, they become anathema to them. They don't talk to them. They don't see them. They don't look at them. They never speak to them again. That's the word here that Peter brings upon himself. It literally means to bring down a curse upon himself. He's a little out of control. Who knows what it really sounded like when he said, "I do not know him." And the cock crows. It's not 1 a.m., folks. The cock crows because it's probably 6 in the morning. This has been going on all night. And Jesus has been up on that porch, being beaten, being mocked, had one insult thrown, another, questions tormented at him. He's been basically beaten senseless for about 6 or 7 hours. And at that point, the first rooster crowing for the morning, it's maybe nautical twilight, but it's still dark, crows. And at that point, Peter looks up at what happens of all things. Jesus looks straight at him. Can you imagine? Can you imagine? And the weight of what he's done hits him right then, right there. And Jesus' words come back to him. "Before the cock crows, Peter, he soared into heaven with his courage. And we look to him as the first among the disciples throughout the millennia. And yet he fell farther than any of them. Betrayal by firelight. Maybe a fire like this." Here's where it hits home for us. Peter is you. And he's me. Because we're no different. The expedient thing happens, and what do? Tonight is the night for us to remember those moments when we can soar to heaven and we sense the Holy Spirit among us. And tonight is also a night for us to remember those nights when we have blown it so badly. And I'd like to try to get you to think about what it must be like to have Jesus' eyes right on you as you do that. Eyes of love but disappointment. Tonight's the night when we remember that. Tonight marks the time that trumps everything else in the church. Maundy, Thursday, Good Friday, Holy Saturday, the Paschal Vigil. For 2,000 years we have said, This is the most important thing about who we are and what we do. So tonight is the night when we remember God. Love him. He was such a massive screw up. And yet at the same thing, he was the one that Christ said, "You are my rock, and upon you I build my church." And we're not any different. The blessing and the bane, we get in our own way sometimes. Tonight's the night to remember that. Yeah, tonight's the night to feel a little bad. Tonight's the night for us to remember we're the ones that sent Jesus to that cross. What begins tonight and goes through tomorrow till noontime tomorrow, when we remember about that time he's hung on the cross and 3 hours later he's going to be dead, we put him there. It's hard to say. You know, I love Sunday morning, and you hear me saying it when I go, "The peace of our Lord Jesus be with you." It's the best thing I say. Well, tonight I don't say it because there is no peace. We're going to leave here and go home, maybe have a late dinner. He's going to leave here and go die for us. That's what we remember. And it's appropriate we remember it. Peter brings that message to us across the centuries. Let's not waste it. Let's make sure we hear it and hear it real clearly. In a few moments, we're going to pray responsively. And then once we finish that, we're going to listen to music. And listen to music that has meaning for us. And after that, the bell's going to toll 35 times. Once for each year of Jesus' life among us. And as it tolls, these torches, one by one, are going to be put out. Till finally, the one here is the last one snuffed. And when it is, I invite you to do what I'm going to do. It's what Peter did. Let's just go slink off into the dark. Maybe we do weep bitterly, but we certainly go recognizing our complicity in what we commemorate. He's going to that cross for us. He's going to that cross because of us. And tonight is the night we remember that. It's important. And we know that. God bless Peter for bringing us the message. I bash him in all of my sermons so much, and yet at the same time betrayed Jesus as blatantly as he did, but don't forget he had the courage to walk through this fire. As you leave, if you've written a prayer, bring it to the fire like Peter did. We will go and we will enter the Paschal Vigil, and the next time we gather, it will be we hear the refrain of what we're looking for on Sunday. It's not time to talk about that tonight. Tonight's something else. Tonight is the night he goes to die for us. Think about it. Think long. Think hard. It's that important. It's not difficult. Let's do pray together. If you'll join me. In the Litany of Shadows. Lord God, your last night with the disciples was spent in the shadow of Friday's cross, a cross you set your face toward on our behalf. With thanks that no words can express, we say now to you, as you sat and broke bread and gave thanks, you were offering your body and blood to us. You were giving your death for our life. That this was necessary, we say. As you cried out to the Father and your disciples slept, we also sleep when your vigil should be ours as well. When the mob comes to arrest you, we are also there, unprepared. And all we can ask is, have mercy. Lord, hear our prayer. Jesus, you always meet evil with the overpowering strength of your love. We meet hate by lashing out in kind. And your words to the one with the sword are also your words spoken to us. to which we can only respond,
Lord, have mercy.
And when you face those who would kill you, we all are indeed like Peter, hiding in the shadows, afraid for ourselves, disowning that we even know you, and hearing the cock crow, we can only go out and bitterly weep. Yes, Lord, have mercy upon us in the hour of your death when we receive your life. Lord, have mercy. Lord, hear our prayer. Amen.